be so good to have lights, the real lights. And,
yeah.
And don't forget the
listening. Yes, that's the important thing.
You know, our poor students, I mean, we've got people who, they literally can't leave. They have nowhere to go because there's either a travel ban to their home country, or in the case of, like, you know, Iranian students, if they go, they're never going to be able to come back. So.
Can you give me a...
Do not touch the microphone. Whatever you do, do not touch the microphone. Don't touch it with your...
Don't touch the microphone.
You sound great. Both sound great.
Annie, try with Annie too. She's talking.
Are you
about
I'm
reading.
For sure.
Yeah.
But we know
Number 9.
Is that your favorite number?
This is Tim testing the balance between the microphone and the sound. I feel like it's pretty good. I could probably both pump the vocals a little bit more. Test 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3, 4. I think that's much nicer. Oh, much nicer.
Pray that all that we do and say and sing and pray may be to your glory and for the strengthening of your people. Good morning and welcome to worship this morning at Christ Episcopal Church here in Needham, Massachusetts, right across the street from the public library. I'm Nick Morris Clement, the rector here, and it's a delight to welcome you from wherever you're coming, whether it's your couch or your patio, wherever you are in your journey with Christ, we're delighted that you're here. It's a particular joy to welcome this morning our guest preacher, the Reverend Dr. Karen Coleman, who is Associate Chaplain for Episcopal Ministry at Boston University and a spiritual director there through the School of Theology. She's also assisting at Trinity Church in Boston on Copley Square. We've been trying to get Karen here for quite a while, since last fall actually, but the stars didn't align until today, and we're delighted to have you back. I understand she hasn't preached from this pulpit since she left in 2007, so I wish we had a better pulpit for you, but we're delighted that you're here, so thank you for being here. Also want to thank Kim Lysett for being our Facebook usher this morning, and her other half, Tim, for running the soundboard, and Annie Russell for being our intercessor and lector this morning. Want to thank also Phil and Priscilla Trussell for gifting us with our hymns, and especially we want to thank you, the body of Christ, for being here for worship this morning. Just a couple of announcements. Many of you have already read the report in the e-blast this week from our regathering team outlining our decision to postpone regathering for physical worship here in this building until mid-fall at the earliest. In consultation with the diocesan guidelines and the directions of the Commonwealth, and for the love of our neighbor, we believe this is the best course of action. Precisely what our program schedule will look like in the fall is still to be determined, but rest assured that safety will be our number one concern. And in keeping with diocesan guidelines, we will not be singing up here, which may be just as well, as we haven't figured out how to maintain the 20 feet between masked singers that is now considered best practices. So you'll have to sing along with the choir extra loud at home. It's part of loving our neighbors. Speaking of loving our neighbors, thank you to the households who produced 50 bags of groceries for Be Safe. We did it. I knew we'd be able to do it. And thank you to Kathleen Kelly for coordinating the efforts. If you've signed up, you'll be hearing more from Kathleen about precisely where to deliver those grocery bags. Finally, I want to draw your attention to the events across the street this afternoon, sponsored by current students and alums of the high school. It's called The Art of Black Lives Matter. It's about art, but it's about more than that. There promise to be exhibits looking at the ways in which we as a society must do better at creating an anti-racist society of freedom and justice for all. It runs from 3 to 5 on the upper parking lots at the high school, and masks and physical distancing will be in effect. So please come and support our young people as they lead us on this journey towards justice. Now, there should be a button to click on to open a bulletin on our website, if you're watching on our website, as well as a bulletin at the top of your Facebook feed. And do sign in on Facebook. If you're watching on Facebook, it's really a thrill to see people sign in and say hello to one another and to be greeted by our usher. It really helps us to enjoy one another's company as we worship. Finally, we'll begin with the prelude, pre-recorded by Steve Sussman, and then we'll continue with our opening hymn. Again, welcome to worship. Thank you.
Eternal Father, strong to save. Hymn 608.
We give thanks to you, O God, we give thanks, calling upon your name and declaring all your wonderful deeds. Let us confess our sins to God. God of all mercy, we confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our lives. We have denied your goodness in each other, in ourselves, and in the world you have created. We repent of the evil that enslaves us, the evil we have done, and the evil done on our behalf. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us through our Savior, Jesus Christ, that we may abide in your love and serve only your will. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. O God, let our mouths proclaim your praise.
And your
praise to the holy and undivided Trinity, one God, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. We pray the invitatory psalm responsively, breaking at the asterisk. God is the rock of our salvation. O come, let us worship. O God, you are my God. Eagerly I seek you.
My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a barren and dry land where there is no water.
Therefore I have gazed upon you in your holy place,
that I might behold your power and your glory.
For your loving kindness is better than life itself.
My lips shall give you praise.
So will I bless you as long as I live. My soul is content, as with marrow and fatness.
And my mouth praises you with joyful lips.
When I remember you upon my bed,
and meditate on you in the night watch.
For you have been my helper.
And under the shadow of your wings I will rejoice.
My soul clings to you.
Your right hand holds me fast.
God is the rock of our salvation. Oh, come, let us worship.
The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 119, verses 105 to 112, and it is read responsively, breaking at the asterisk. Your word is a lantern to my feet,
and a light upon my path.
I have sworn and am determined
to keep your righteous judgments.
I am deeply troubled.
Preserve my life, O Lord, according to your word.
Accept, O Lord, the willing tribute of my lips,
and teach me your judgments.
My life is always in my hand,
yet I do not forget your law.
The wicked have set a trap for me,
but I have not strayed from your commandments.
Your decrees are my inheritance forever.
Truly, they are the joy of my heart.
I have applied my heart to fulfill your statutes
forever and to the end.
Praise to the holy and undivided Trinity, one God, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. A reading from the book of Genesis. These are the descendants of Isaac, Abraham's son. Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac was 40 years old when he married Rebekah, daughter of Bethuel the Aramean of Paddan Aram, sister of Laban the Aramean. Isaac prayed to the Lord for his wife because she was barren, and the Lord granted his prayer, and his wife Rebekah conceived. The children struggled together within her, and she said, "If it is to be this way, why do I live?" So she went to inquire of the Lord, and the Lord said to her, "Two nations are in your womb, and two peoples born of you shall be divided. The one shall be stronger than the other. The elder shall serve the younger." When her time to give birth was at hand, there were twins in her womb. The first came out red, all his body like a hairy mantle, so they named him Esau. Afterward, his brother came out, with his hand gripping Esau's heel, so he was named Jacob. Isaac was 60 years old when she bore them. When the boys grew up, Esau was a skilled hunter, a man of the field, while Jacob was a quiet man, living in tents. Isaac loved Esau because he was fond of game, but Rebekah loved Jacob. Once when Jacob was cooking a stew, Esau came in from the field and he was famished. Esau said to Jacob, "Let me eat some of that red stuff, for I am famished." Therefore, he was called Edom. Jacob said, "First, sell me your birthright." Esau said, "I am about to die. Of what use is a birthright to me?" Jacob said, "Swear to me first." So he swore to him and sold his birthright to Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and lentil stew, and he ate and drank, and rose and went his way. Thus Esau despised his birthright. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
The response, the Song of the Wilderness, is read responsively, breaking at the asterisk. The wilderness and the dry land shall be glad.
The desert shall rejoice and blossom.
It shall blossom abundantly.
And rejoice with joy and singing.
They shall see the glory of the Lord.
The majesty of our God.
Strengthen the weary hands.
Make firm the feeble knees.
Say to the anxious, "Be strong, do not fear."
Here is your God, coming to judgment to save.
Then shall the eyes of the blind be opened,
and the ears of the deaf be unstopped.
Then shall the lame leap like a deer,
and the tongue of the speechless sing for joy.
For waters shall break forth in the wilderness,
and streams in the desert.
The burning sand shall become a pool,
and the thirsty ground springs of water.
The ransomed of God shall return with singing,
and everlasting joy upon their heads.
Joy and gladness shall be theirs,
and sorrow and sighing shall flee away.
Praise to the holy and undivided Trinity, one God, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Reading from Matthew's Gospel. Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path. And the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Let anyone with ears listen. Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. That is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while. And when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another case 60, and in another 30. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
All that you touch, you change. All that you change, changes you. The only lasting truth is change. Octavia Butler, Parable of the Sower. Parable of the Sower, Octavia E. Butler's sci-fi Afro-futuristic novel, has now been adapted for the stage, which was going to debut this spring through Arts Emerson's Cutler Majestic Theater. With music and lyrics composed by Toshi Reagan in collaboration with her mother, Bernice Johnson Reagan, who you might know from the social justice group Sweet Honey in the Rock. It is the story of Lauren Olamina, who lives in a not-so-distant America, where climate change has driven society to violence and the brink of extinction. When she loses both family and home, she ventures out into the unknown. What begins as a desperate fight for survival leads to something more profound, a startling vision of human destiny that bursts the seeds of a new faith. So here we are at the 13th chapter of Matthew's Gospel, also known as the Justice Gospel. Jesus has become well known throughout the nearby cities and villages. Many who followed him have seen and experienced his acts of mercy, how he has cured lepers, raised the sick from their beds, and brought the dead back to life. As he traveled from place to place, Jesus taught people, his disciples, many things like God's goodness, how to go about their daily life and work, care for their neighbor, love of their enemies, and how to pray. His messages were clear and spoken in a way that most would understand. The crowd's growing so much that in today's gospel, Jesus finds himself teaching from a boat while people are gathered along the shore. He has already picked up John the Baptizer's announcement about the nearness of the reign of God, and so we are moved into transformation from the invisible to the visible presence of God here on earth. And as his time to go to Jerusalem draws near, there's an urgency to bring this new faith to life, much like Lauren's. Today's parable is the first of many stories that Jesus told so that they might get a better picture of the reign of God that exists on earth. Over and over again, he would use images that most of his listeners would be able to relate to. The reign of God is like a mustard seed, like a treasure in a field, like yeast, like a great pearl, like a net let down into the sea. So this parable of the sower is a familiar one to us. It's very simply, a sower goes out to throw seeds and scatter seeds everywhere. During this pandemic time, many of us have bought seeds or seedlings that were either delivered by mail, curbside pickup, or we stood in line at our local nursery. We planted them in neat rows of containers and marked what we had planted where. We took the time to methodically prepare the soil and map out where each seed or seedling was to go. But the sower scatters seeds everywhere, Some of it falls on hard ground, clearly exposed, and it's immediately snatched up by the birds. Some of it falls on ground full of gravel and little soil. The seed grows up quickly, but then dies from lack of nourishment. The tender plants wither away. Some of the seeds fell among the thorns, and the thorns eventually choked the plants, and they died. And the last of the seed fell on good, rich soil, and luscious plants grew. We hear this story, and it is easy enough to wonder what soil we might be. We know the beaten path of life and what it is to be packed down. At some point, our lives have become rocky patches. We have been bruised and scratched by the thorns of life, and we have known the experience of having our feet firmly planted in good spaces where all is right with the world. If we hear this parable and equate it with the seed being the word of God, again, we might wonder what kind of soil we are. Are we that hard, rocky, and thorny soil? Well, nothing will grow. Or are we well-weeded and fertilized soil? Are we among the hard soil people who hear the word of God but do not take it to heart? Are we the rocky soil people where the seed of God blossoms for a while but then we get bored and move on? Are we among those who hear the word of God but then we get tangled up and distracted by worldly goods? Jesus did not introduce this parable by saying, this is the kind of soil the sower had to work with. This is the kind of dirt you should be. He said, listen, a sower went out to sow. With any parable that Jesus taught, there's always more layers than first appears. We hear this parable and think it's a story about us. The story is less about us and more about the reign of God. In particular, it is a story about who God is. It is about the abundance of God. And let me repeat this. It is about the abundance of God. God is a benevolent sower who, since the beginning of all creation, has cast bountiful seeds of goodness and grace upon everything and everyone that has been and will be ever created. God is a gracious sower who is not stingy with his seed, but who casts it freely. God is a magnificent sower who does not distinguish between the good soil and the not so good soil. No ground and no one is undeserving of God's seeds, of God's blessings, that God scatters to the far reaches of the earth. This goes along with what Jesus told the crowds earlier in Matthew's gospel. He makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. Later, Jesus says, let anyone with ears listen. If we have heard this parable, we will find that there is yet another layer that we should consider. That as Christians, we are not off the hook when it comes to sowing seeds. Part of the plan is that as followers of Christ, we too are to announce that God's reign is right here in our midst. Like Lauren in the parable of the sower, we are to sow God's words in the places we go and to everyone we meet. It is not up to us to determine whether others' soil is arid or rocky, or threatened with thorns or by hungry birds. It is not up to us to determine who is worthy or less worthy of the gift that is sown. We are simply to sow and let God, the sower, do the rest. Amen.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Hear our cry, O God.
And listen to our prayer.
Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
The suffrages. Help us, O God, our Savior.
Deliver us and forgive us our sins.
Look upon your congregation.
Give to your people the blessing of peace.
Declare your glory among the nations.
And your wonders among all peoples.
Do not let the oppressed be shamed and turned away.
Never forget the lives of your poor.
Continue your loving kindness to those who know you.
And your favor to those who are true of heart.
Satisfy us by your loving kindness in the morning.
So shall we rejoice and be glad all the days of our life. O Lord, mercifully receive the prayers of your people who call upon you, and grant that they may know and understand what things they ought to do, and also may have grace and power faithfully to accomplish them. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Sanctify, O Lord, those whom you have called to the study and practice of the arts of healing, and to the prevention of disease and pain. And lift up those who in administrative and custodial roles to support the wellness in clinical settings. Strengthen them by your life-giving spirit, that by their ministries, the health of the community may be promoted and your creation glorified. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. O God of all power and love, we give you thanks for your unfailing presence and the hope you provide in times of uncertainty and loss. Send your Holy Spirit to enkindle in us your holy fire. Revive us to live as Christ's body in the world, a people who pray, worship, learn, break bread, share life, heal neighbors, bear good news, seek justice, rest and grow in the Spirit. Wherever and however we gather, unite us in common prayer and send us in common mission, that we and the whole creation might be restored and renewed through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I invite your prayers and petitions, either silently or aloud, or in the chat feature in Facebook. We remember before you, O God, your church throughout the world, especially Michael, our presiding bishop, Alan and Gail, our bishops, Carol, our regional canon, Amy, dean of our cathedral, Nick, our priest, and Karen, our preacher, and her ministries at Boston University. We lift up our siblings at St. Luke's in Lazille, Haiti, and Father Melor, their pastor, and our siblings at the Mana community at our cathedral, and Jennifer McCracken, their pastor. We pray for religious communities everywhere who are organizing for justice. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give you thanks, O God, for all who continue to serve the common good in this time of pandemic as medical professionals in clinical, research, and administrative settings, as store clerks and shelf stockers and restaurant workers, as delivery people, as custodians and cleaners, as public service and safety workers. We pray for those juggling work and childcare responsibilities. We give you thanks for the progress we are making with the virus in the Commonwealth, and we remain prayerful for good judgment as we move further into phase three of reopening. We pray for wise leadership in other parts of the country and the world where infections are rising. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We remember before you, O God, members serving our country in the armed services and law enforcement agencies, remembering especially Sean, Ian, Jack, Colin, Tim, and Andrew. We give thanks for all the public servants in our land who faithfully live out the call to make this land the home of the free and the brave for all people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We remember before you, O God, all those in sickness, danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble, including Mary, Barbara, Lynn, Bob, Susan, Steve, James, Cynthia, Mark, Chuck, Ed, Linda, all singers and instrumentalists whose ministry is vital at this time, John, James, Nick M., Gail, Marianne and family, Linda Evans, for all those in grief and pain, resulting especially from the devastation of the COVID virus and from racial injustice, and for those striving to unlearn our attitudes and actions that perpetuate individual and structural racism. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And we remember before you, O God, those who have died, especially Anne Marie Carleo, in whose memories the altar flowers are given this morning. Are there others to remember?
Felix, Sophie,
Aaron,
Janet, Barbara.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages.
Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O God, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting. Amen. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
What a friend we have in Jesus.
Listen for the postlude, and then to join one another with Zoom coffee hour.